那我再说。
那怎么这样说？
My name is Miko.
I used to be in Amsterdam at the same time as Shula, but just a coincidence.
And, oh, yes.
Yeah, actually, it's great to see that it's sort of some strangers around the time. Be great. Thanks so much.
Hello, I'm Yoshi Shimakuna. I'm a subsidiary of Hitachi in Tokyo. And I'm in charge of a team and visual design project that explores a new concept for social innovation. She will explain more about it later. Next week.
Public servants to citizens, whoever have an idea or
然后今天我，sorry， 他们穿的话，好，他们的 effort 很足，低分的 numbers 不高。And I'm a PBS researcher, PBS already, and most of the people call me Rita, so maybe you can call me like that. And before I'm a citizen journalist and also a open source worker, and I write code and write. And as far as I want to come to the government to church meetings or which article to talk about the society issue. That's because I think before I'm a coder, I was in tech and work at a hacker. And an article is called How to Become a Hacker, and this is the link. And I think the law can use come to change the society or to the government. And in this article, the theory says there has five important attitudes. And one is the world is full of fascinating problems to be solved. So we need to be, have patience to solve this problem. And we need to learn a lot of things and to find good problems to solve. And second is the problem shall never have to be solved twice. So if you solve this problem, you can write an article tell people about how you fix it and how to solve it. And make another people can solve it by the way that we've done. And they do not need to invest the real trust. And burden and drudgery are legal. So if you feel something really boring, you can make it automatic. Not to waste your brain on it every time. You should use the code to replace it. And the freedom is good because if someone can order you, they sometimes will. If you are solving a good problem, and if they can order you, sometimes they can stop you to do a thing. And to do something is really stupid, like to feel the form every time. And so freedom is good, so you need to against the you need to against the order that is you should hold the freedom. And the attitude is no substitute for competence, so you need to work hard to practice to have the competence to solve another problem. And the five attitudes are always to the same rules to make everyone's creative can collaboration together. Because your brain is a really a very good resource, so you do not need to waste it on other things. So if everyone can share their way to solve the problem, and we can use our brain on other things and not to even the wheel every time. But when we look at the policy making process in Taiwan, and this is a video that play this. And this is work done by an NGO in Taiwan. That is, this is our policy. And, sorry, because this is Chinese, so I translate it. And at first, and this is a small circle they discuss. Does we want, should we do a policy A? And then they will discuss another plan like plan B or plan C. Then they have probably, they think the plan B is better than plan C. And so after that, they decide to do plan B, not plan B or plan C. And they will make young people to write the reason why we need to do plan B and why plan B is better. And they will find a professor or the teacher that support plan B to write to research the way to do the plan B. And they have a meeting said about a speech about the NP and let people to know how it's NP. And there will become a news that there will announce a press talking about it will be to do the NP. Then someone hired the politician, they will ask them why you need to do the plan B, and they want them to change the plan. And so they go to they try to make a plan B. Then other people and outside they ask about what must the detail of the plan B, but they don't no one dare to answer the question. And they talk to outside say that maybe the plan B and plan E will execute together at the same time. Then someone, the politician told them not to say the things like that. So they announced the plan B. And the plan B has a lot of because they has a lot of
comfortable,
so they cannot push. And it's super, it's hard to say why they need to plan B because that is the politician why they want to do. And they don't know why. And because they are public servants and they need to write down what the things that they need to do. And so they need to fill a lot of form. But also they hold a lot of meeting that pretend the plan B is pushing, but actually not. And because they later to K21, because they say they want to do the plan B, so they have a lot of they have some KPIs about the plan B. And but they announced the plan E, but the KPI is about the plan D. So but plan E cannot dispute and nothing can report. So they just can write a lot of words, but the words do nothing. So that's most or some policy in Taiwan is just solution like that. So this is because of bureaucracy is about the instrumental reason, and they are into mostly efficiency. They avoid the conflict. They will sometimes more complicated. So that's the problem because they obey the instrumental reason. So someone will talk about the complicated reason that will most be like equality, diversity, transparency, rational discussion. So we have some very dirty democracy. And so we want to know that if we want to discuss something and we have a meeting, And if we want the result will accept by most of the people, we sometimes we will find the most diversity people coming. But if you find too much people, the meeting will hard to is hard to going on. And so this is if you have enough people and your result maybe will be denied by a lot of people, and if you have a lot of people, the meeting is hard to go on. So we need to find the best number of people to have this kind of meeting. And so we probably a number of people. And this is a rule that if the people that come to the meeting, they make a good decision, the possibility to make a good decision is over than 50%. And if we find more people coming to the meeting, they will do a better result than lower number of people. And but if their possibility to do the poor decision is lower than 50%, the result of the meeting will be bad. And if we want people to, if we suggest that people will do good decision is based on they know a lot of information and they can know diversity opinion and they can talk to each other and have reasonable talking and they can make good decision. So people need information to have this kind of good decision and to make their possibility to do the good decisions possibility is over 50% and to make the result of the meeting will better. So in PDIS we will use the pre-meeting information collection. We will read a paper, we will do some interview and to some people that they know the context of this issue. And we will do something for we will make a menu, it's about our issue, and give the people to come to the meeting. And we will put the people together and at the same place, discussion together. So we have at last, we will make the information transfer. So we will have sometimes we will have the post meeting and talk to people about the result of the meeting and make them the better policy. So this is the five stage of the policy making, like the policy formation, and they will find out what is the problem. And the policy formulation will find maybe a result, the way to resolve the problem, and policy adoption to make it to a law or a rule, and then to exclude and to examine it. And if we start this meeting at the later stage, the policy modifying range is indicated and cannot do a lot of change. So if we can do it at first, we can maybe the result will be better for our citizens. And so, this kind of presentation meeting, we make it into a rule in Taiwan, and the rule says that we need transparency, participation, accountability, and inclusive. And so I think the challenge for PDIS here is that I would like to use this triangle is by the person the triangle is the citizen, politician, and the public servant. The citizen should join the meeting and they need to be more inclusive. They need to try to talk, listen other opinion and talk about the things, and I can join the reasonable discussion. And the public servant should join the meeting to talk about the problem and improve the policy. And at last, we need a politician, and they can trust this mechanism, and they can get a resource for this mechanism. And while the meeting has a result, they can take the opportunity to ask the public servant to do this. But if it is our politician, the Hong-Chi-Tang, she just do half of the politician. She find the resource for us to do the things like that. But right now, she has no right to take the opportunity to ask the public servant should do like this. So that's our challenge. So we need the politician to comment the bureaucracy and the diversity process. So that's our challenge. Thank you.
Any question?
Sure.
Broadcasting platform called Lighthouse In. We still do it today. And this is one of last year's broadcasts where you can see Audrey in the back, where she was first appointed visual minister, and she was sitting here while the general questioning of the new cabinet was happening. And then we also have a live chat room on the side where we can talk about what's happening inside Congress. So that sort of helps us bring together the community of concerned citizens. And then we started to do one of the first other things that we did was to edit commercial videos to make them 1 or 2 minute clips. So that's fun to watch. So we do highlights for the people and upload them to YouTube. And this is one of our beloved legislator in the Kuomintang party. And then that's our, I think he's the chief of, he's the department head of the Justice Department or something like that. Right. And then this is one other thing where we were trying to confirm our new Supreme Court justices or Constitutional Court justices. And that's one of our newly elected legislator, Freddie. And then this one also caused a lot of buzz because when we're debating how do we modify our labor code, this guy went on the stage inside Congress and claimed that there's no deaths from overwork in Taiwan, and that's definitely bullshit. But he said that. this one, and we started to do also fun videos where our journalists would go onto the street and interview people about stuff, what happened, mostly protests, some other gatherings. This one was about pension reform, because our government used to promise a very good pension to retired public servants, but our government cannot afford that anymore, so the government is trying to push for reform. Of course, that got a lot of people upset. So there were protesting, and then we went on to sort of interview them. And one of them was like, which means very rich. And that started as like a trend where people use the phrase "end" a lot of times. It means very, but in a funny way. We also produce a lot of manga. We have an in-house illustrator who does all the manga. She's also an independent artist that has her own brand. But she works with us to produce a lot of these politically aware manga, either a single frame or a series or script. And this is where Trump was elected, and there was Duterte in the Philippines. And we're trying to draw parallels between those two and our mayor, which is controversial, and that got a lot of attention and discussion. We also do things that we call lazy packs, or lazy info pack, which is to sort of condense a very complicated issue to like 10 slides of images and text. So this one is explaining like why do we need pension reform. And it features this really sneaky character in the back that's like don't tell the truth. So a lot of humor in our work. And of course, we also do some more serious stuff like data journalism, or this one is about, we're trying to sort of make the audiences tell us that what their conception of our government is. So this one is specifically about tourism in Taiwan. So we're all saying that after the GDP government, our tourism went down because our relationship with China went down. But as data shows, it's not as people would believe. So we decided to, hey, just do you mind like draw the curve for us on our webpage, and then we will show you the real data. So it's data journalism plus interactive design, that's the way. And this one was really popular. It was last year. So we digged up a lot of historical material during the martial law period, and we decided to sort of make a simulation game. So you go to this website and be like presented a couple of choices. Say you're a student and you're trying to sort of decide which club you would want to go to, and then you want to go to yourself. So say like a study club, and then you went up, you ended up in jail for 10 years, something like that. That's a real story that happened during the martial law sort of period. So that sparked a large discussion, and this link even went to China. So this link was spread on Weibo and everything else, and they were talking about martial law and Chiang Kai-shek and all that stuff. Okay. So that was activist media, and then the second one is Democracy Lab, so I think I can pick it up a little bit. So this is the first thing that we did, was ask your mayor. That was during 2014, the mayoral election, where we built a website, and so people could submit their questions, and as long as enough people think that this question is valid, we would ask the candidates to answer them. And this one was, we interviewed the former mayor of Taipei, which was also our former president, Li Yonghui. And we also did 2016 Ask for President, which we asked, which was invited three, and then KMT decided to change their candidate, but still three. We invited three of them to participate in this forum. And our questions actually went into the TV debate. So it replaced sort of the traditional like media company president asking questions. But now this time in 2016 it's ordinary citizens asking questions, and that's through all forums. And then in 2017 we started doing issue-oriented asking sessions, and this one is about sports reform. We hosted, this one was to the sports minister, this one is to legislators who's inside the educational committee who's responsible for sports administration. And during all these events, we started to do like workshop-like discussions and group discussions. So groups of participants will come up with their own questions and then elect a representative inside the group so that they would go on to question the legislators, just like this. So one, each of them pick a side. Well, the people stand on this side of the room, and then the legislators stand on that side. That's the tradition of our Congress. So we're starting to like emulate that environment. And then this one was we did in Tainan. We were invited potential Tainan mayoral candidates, and we experimented this fan thing, which has a push on one side, and the other side is like what? Boo. So good, bad, and then during their talk, during their answers, they would hold up their hands to sort of show their appreciation or disapproval. And then this year was a big project for us. It was about the Chiang Kai-shek Memorial Hall. So it is a project initiated by the Ministry of Culture. So we decided to take on that big task and hosted 7 visionary workshops about how do we as a people think about Chiang Kai-shek and his memorial hall here in Taipei. And then during the second one, there was a protest outside of the workshop. So this is sort of, we see it as a necessary process during our experiment and the practice of democracy is where conflicts will start. And then we try to turn it into conversations. So this is still conflict. So you'll see this is a live stream of the conflict outside. This is where they were trying to host a workshop inside the room. And they were demanding that why can't we go in? We're citizens as well. You know, our voice is a voice. You know, even though we're old, we're still citizens here. This is where the protesters are talking with our colleagues surrounded by the police. This is also one of the leaders of the protesters. And then you will see the same person inside the workshop. So he attended the following workshop along with some of his colleagues, also protesters, during the second workshop. And they were together in the same table with other people, like younger people or historians or urban designers. And it's like a deliberative process. So we see all of this as good. And then you will see some cool ways of discussing it. Like they just spontaneously made up this map of the Memorial Hall and representing the central building with this cupcake. And we were talking about space. Because a few of them were space war, or they specialized in urban space design. And you will see, coincidentally, this other group also did the same thing and during another workshop. So that was really funny for us. And also kind of inspiring to see people really engage, sit down, and talk about this very difficult issue here in Taiwan. And then this photo was just very touching to me. Let me explain. This video we shot during an interview of an old soldier, retired veteran, who still lives in Taipei. And he's very sympathetic to Chiang Kai-shek at all, and the old administration. And he has, you know, this ribbon saying that he's a old hero of the Civil War against the communists. He had a photo with former President Ma Ying-jeou. And then, you know, with all these commemorative memories of him. And he's sitting there, he's like, I feel sorry for Chiang Kai-shek, you know, for him doing all this for our nation, and he's under such scrutiny. And then this person right here, he is one of the victims during the White Terror or the martial law period, where he and his family were suppressed and oppressed by the administration. But then this workshop sort of painfully but necessarily is trying to, you know, juxtapose those two historic experiences and trying to find a way for us to move forward. So this is sort of very difficult but still very necessary for us. And this video is sort of turning it back to the fun thing, where it shows a little bit of like how we see all this. This is a simulation of representative democracy as a social experiment, and we also try to come up with, you know, small mechanisms during the workshop to make the discussion flow and to just to facilitate people to let them speak their own voice. Yeah. So the third part is where we are civic educators. When this project started, we decided to start with philosophy because we think that philosophy is the basis of all sort of humanitarian thinking and also just deliberation. So we started this philosophy community where people who study philosophy would come together and talk about how do we introduce philosophical concepts to the general public, how can they write articles that people can better understand, you know, what does Kant think about this, what is the, you know, what is the, can't come up with a good sense. Be like, this is called, you know, conservatism in same-sex marriage, and this is other people thinking about, you know. Well, this slide, this screenshot is obviously taken when same-sex marriage was a big topic here. So we also try to pair philosophical thinking and arguments with current issues. These articles will be debated and sort of worked on collaboratively on this forum and also during a physical meetups. And then these articles will be published on one of the bigger platforms here, which is United Daily News. And then some more people will see these articles. And of course, because we have an illustrator, we do mangas about this philosophical concepts, so people can understand them in a fun way. We also published a book that's based on this, the content generated by the forum. And then we hosted a very big gathering last year on philosophy. So we invited 8 major organizations in Taiwan and Hong Kong that's doing popularization of philosophy. And also, no more mangas. also, mangas about little knowledge about Congress is also very important, because when you're trying to supervise something, you first need to understand it. So this one is about, you know, what are these people when sitting when you see like a broadcasting of Congress. This is the conveyor, the one who convenes the meeting. This is you know, some other stuff and stuff like that. So this is where they say, like, how do we vote on a proposition inside Congress? You know, we have this thing, which your name is shown on the screen, and then you either vote yes or no. Yes is a green, and the vote is a no is a red, I think. And then here it mentions that in Japan you have this wooden plaque, and then you would vote with that. In America, it's yell. Like, yay, or I think I or they. And then the illustrator is trying to ask from there. So the last part is that we are a tech developer. That's where my department is working on, which is to write code and design stuff. And then this started again with the 2014 Ask Your Mayor project, where we built our first website. And then it quickly became visualizations of stuff, right? This is where we visualized 2,000 plus congressional records about what said, who said what during the last, during Congress, during 2012 to 2016, which is before the last election. And we grouped them on issues and stuff. This website you can still go on. And this is where we visualize the change of, this is where we visualize the change of each legislator's stance on certain issues, say, before and after the election. And this is one of our most current work is the topical data lab, which is we visualize data in a more systematic way according to their topics. And this one is showing the frequency of legislator speech on a certain topic. And it's of course interactive. You can click and you can filter and you can look at each statement. And you can also link each statement to its original source, which is on Congress, on the website of Congress. Yeah. And then we also started doing some voting experiments online. This is where when we hosted one of our Ask events, we tried to build a system for people to choose who they want to ask the most, and then we invite whoever the people choose. And then we have just a bunch of projects going on right now. Some of them I can't really talk yet. That will be revealed probably later this year, but this is sort of what it looks like. We have basically a central part that is for our members, and through it, they will have access to all these different services. This is our core, which is our Azure API server, and all the logic is here. And this is where we present our data on all the legislators and politicians. And this one is for our data team to enter data and try to do analytics on them. And this is where we talked about our media experiments, where we do these data journalism and also just media experiments in general. And this is where we keep our articles, because our company used to be very decentralized and sort of flat. But now we're trying to at least sort of centralize the information system. The content that's generated through each project and have synergy across them. So they wouldn't stand alone, they would link to each other and have better value. And then finally, this is our major project this year, which is about local elections at the end of the year. We try to host ask events for all of them, while at least the six major cities in China. Right. And it's not only about coding and tech, we also try to sort of as my personal agenda, trying to push more of my colleague into coding. So this is an example of this is me, and this is my colleague who doesn't know how to code, but he uses GitHub so that he could modify our projects, the content of our projects. And so we think that this is important for the tech person to build a platform, but it's also important for non-tech people to use these platforms to generate towards the public. And then we also attend a lot of these civic tech events, like this one, and then Civic Tech Fest during 2017, which was hosted by Open Culture Foundation. We hosted workshops to share our experiences and maybe talk about some. And then finally, we have a hackathon coming up at the end of the month. This one's place called Archipelago, which I'm part of. We're trying to just create more space for people who want to work on open culture and participation. Yeah. So that's it. This is our group portrait, and thank you very much. It varies from time to time right now. full-time plus part-time, it's around, I would say it's around 16 people. We're based here in the UK. We're very close to the 2-8 part, which is next to all the important government buildings. So we can run to, yeah.
You know, also probably
yes, definitely. This is we can't do it on our own. Saying about the ask events, we have to do a lot of communications with all the different campaigns. We also work with a lot of NGOs to do a lot of topic-oriented work because they are the experts. Say environmental issue, we work with environmental NGOs and other issues with other NGOs. So generally, that's the case. We, as far as tech go, we're still trying to find a good model, a good balance between business and open culture. Because I think not a lot of people are doing what we're doing right now here in Taiwan. Because it's an NGO, nonprofit, or it's just a business, you know, like mainstream media companies. Well, we're open to a lot of different opportunities and possibilities. Also, we are a very small team, so there's a lot we want to do, but there's only so little time to go.
Yeah. First of all, thanks for sharing. I think it's really inspiring to see, like, there's so many things that you do, and you only have, like, 60 people, so that's really impressive.
That's also, like, an aggregation from 2014, so.
Right, yeah, and also you make politics really like closer to live and public, so then people can be easily accessed to, and also young people can really understand, because sometimes when you first get into some type of politics, you probably think it's boring, it's not your business, but it's actually very important in your life, so I think what you did is actually amazing. But I have two questions for you. So the first thing is that since it's about politics, what's the relationship with the government? Do you do collaboration with them, or do you, like, can you tell us a bit more? And also, I'm curious, since that you are in this PDS, so what's the relationships between them?
Between this?
Yeah.
Okay, sure. Let me just spell all the secrets. no, there's no secret. So Watch Out was started when I wasn't here. In 2013, I wasn't here for starting the company. So that first disclaimer. So from what I know, we don't have any relationship or official relationship with the government. As far as we are a potential collaborator. So for example, the Chiang Kai-shek Memorial Home Project, we are a contractor. So we submit our proposal to the government saying that, hey, we think we can do this. How about you give me the money? And they said, okay. And that was an open sort of, how do you say, like an open contracting period. You know, as all the government projects go, it will have to be like an open period for anyone to submit. And if we submitted, some other people submitted, and then we were chosen to do this. So I think that's the model, that's the relationship we have with the government. Nothing else, you know, officially, I think, you know.
Go ahead.
back and she came back.
Right.
And she took the job. Okay.
She took the job.
She
was the person I look up to. It's like the person who first stepped in and acted this disability ceremony. I started to learn from him a lot. Because he's also from, he also studied at university in America, from design artist background, and joining the public sector a little bit, and related to public.
That was very, I didn't expect that, because I studied computer science, so that was nothing about politics.
Right.
But it's from what we're at, you know, from what I was told.
But I can see you two, well, I mean, the two companies, like the two sections are doing a lot of the same common. So maybe there's something, I'm sure that you probably talked about it already, like how to collaborate with each other, or like how to start, because then what you did is there's a lot of things related to the government, to the public affairs. So how can you do collaboration more? I can see there will be nice things happening there.
Yeah. I mean, there's definitely a lot of unofficial talks about, well, hey, let's do this.
Exactly.
But then there are certain social sort of positions that we each hold, like each of the organizations hold.
Right.
One is an office, instead of government. One is media. Sort of, they are traditionally sort of,
Yeah. Right.
So we don't know. Maybe there are new sort of models of governance that we haven't discovered yet.
Yeah,
new
ones. Oh, we hope. Yeah, we do organize some collaboration. Not really. Collaboration is also from over.
No, is it?
Yeah, we do something to you guys.
Yeah, we have meetings.
Meetups.
Yeah,
meetups.
Like the first meetup that we had.
It's called OPISOM. It's given
open
participation.
Yeah, we had like a informal meeting with a lot of people that's inside government and outside.
From central.
Yeah, or local.
Local city governments and people who are not from the public sector but we're working out.
Yeah.
We do have this path.
Maybe ideal and do something about it.
Yeah.
Not so many young people either, who somehow deeply involved or even engaged properly in design, or to have that kind of power to broadcast it so widely. Do you think historically or traditionally that has been the case, or is it like a recent change, or what do you think has made this momentum? I think it's very vibrant, and I think it's really nice to see that kind of power. Maybe I shouldn't generalize as all we have.
Right.
There's some differences between big cities and maybe some other places where they have more critical issues that they feel like they need to be engaged and they need to change. But
right,
it's just your personal opinion.
Cool. Because I'm not a veteran activist. there are a lot more people that's more qualified to answer that. But from my short history of participation, I feel like it's a 318 occupying that sort of really that's almost a cliche right now to talk about this. But I was very excited during the and that created a certain political climate that forces the establishment to change or to have the appearance of change. To adopt certain people, certain individuals inside government, to adopt certain slogans that they have to use, or to adopt certain standards that they have to have in order to value themselves. So that's sort of a point of no return, right? Because once something is inside the public conscience, you can't really take it out so easily. Unless you are a Cambridge Analytica or anything. basic. So I feel like that's like a, it's definitely not something that just came out of nowhere. It's a culmination of people's work and it led to that point. And then it just like shoots bullets everywhere and destroys a lot of stuff, but also creates a lot of stuff. And that's like how God Zero was. That's how God Zero got famous during the 318 Occupy movement. That's how Watch Out became very famous, because they reported the incident of this one legislator trying to pass this trade agreement with China in 30 seconds. That also created a lot of different new organizations, civil organizations, NGOs, activists. Like all this practice, in my opinion, this practice, I feel like Taiwanese people, maybe that's a connection with Japanese people, is that we are trained not to express ourselves so much. We are trained to be, you know, like nice and be like conformative. But then, you know, this, if we want to do a governance model, everyone needs to speak up a little more. That, I think that's a very important process for everyone to exercise their right to speak and their ability to speak. We do our job to inform as many people as possible in our limited understanding, and then a lot of people are doing the same thing too. Yeah, so I think it's like a growth, like a growth process for the Taiwanese process.
Okay, so maybe we can come to holistic life. And so today I'm going to share with you about why voice is part of the sector. And I will also share through case studies from here to get you to understand more about what we are actually working on. And then I will bring some points to discussion. So why do I work in public sector? I was really curious about social events and issues like all time. And I like to take a couple of it on those things that surprise me, confuse me. And those are usually social issues. And this has happened before where I live. The government, because they have a new construction building, so they want to remove the train on the pavement. So I was before and after, during and after the process, and I realized there are lots of things that I think it doesn't make sense to me. And I feel like there are lots of things like this. And I feel like I have the responsibility to do something about them. So I decided to move from design to service designer because I wanted something higher level. So I went to RCA, studied design, and then I started working at the British government, mainly in charge of policy. So using design skills to enhance the current traditional way of working to make the policy-making process more open. So understanding the users rather than writing the regulations, writing words, but starting from user needs, understand their needs and problems, and synthesize insights, and then we build a prototype based on their needs. And then we test it, and then we launch, and we write those tests. So, since I started working at the government, those are the questions that we try to answer all the time, including the issues at this moment. How might we make the policy-making process more open, transparent, understanding, accountable, and inclusive? How might we improve the possibilities for collaboration to better help policymakers and the general public make informed decisions and policy? This might sound really complicated. Let me put it in a more simple way. The problems that we are facing doesn't have a single owner, and we have to work together from different aspects, perspectives. And when we actually have time to make a decision in public affairs, we can do it through public hearing, we can do it through voting, and actually there are a lot of approaches to achieve, to make a decision, or to build a society that we want. We can discover lots of different approaches to achieve that. But in order to do that, we need to make sure that we understand the context from this different perspective. So I think this free is more focused on how can we make sure that everyone understands different perspectives and they can put themselves in other shoes. When they are able to do that, then they can make better decisions because they have more information to help them make the decision. And also, how might we cooperate with departmental silos? How might we improve the quality of deliberation and consultation? How might we represent democracy to share the representative power with the people? So this is what we believe. The more people participate to change the infrastructure, the more they are likely to engage. So this is the process that we embrace. The old policy-making process is like policymakers, they come up with policy,
based on the information I can get, maybe from their colleagues or from news, different platforms. And then they make policy. And then the civil servants have to create, to work on the process, system, maintenance, and regulation. And at the end, user who's not always satisfied with the policy. But what else can they do? Because the regulation has been made, so usually we can just leave it. We can only just leave it like that. And the new process that we're proposing is to put all different users at the heart in the beginning. The users are not just end users, but also policymakers, professionals, and all different kinds of people. And then we understand the problem and needs, then we create the service that responds to their different problems. And then we create system, policy, regulation, and when they help out for people, because everyone has been, everyone's idea has been completed, so there won't be too much problem after that. So talk about silos. We have fragmented trainings and knowledge before, like since in the public sector, there are lots of trainings for civil servants. And then already like before the digital minister, she was actually helping the government to train some of the civil servants. But because of the problem that I mentioned before, lots of capability cannot be accumulated. And we have to train all over again and again. So I think the office is set up the PO network. I think I've mentioned that before. We built the community that involves 31 different civil servants for different ministries to be in the community. And we train them. So when we want to work on the project that requires cross-ministerial collaboration, then we have someone to turn to. And they have the capability because we always train them and work together and learn from each other. So we recruit those passionate civil servants and authorize them for you. So this is, we have 31 ministries, and we select 1 to 5 people from each ministry to see the projects of the PO network. And they record paraphrase and facilitate citizens to co-work with them to respond to a particular policy. This is how it looks like when we were working together. So today I'm going to quickly go through two projects that we have worked on. So previous one, online content system redesign. So this project was raised by one citizen on the institution website that we have in Taiwan. This is how the original online text system looked like. You can see there are lots of information, different ways of entering the system. So the Ministry of Finance, the participation officer from the Ministry of Finance, he thinks this is a crucial issue that we have to work together to solve. So those are the stakeholders that we invited and to come to the workshop that we host. And the reason why we invite them is because I mentioned before about the voting system. To have a say through the voting system makes people decide something from their own perspective, like I want this person or this is good to me. But if we discuss public
actually help them to do the process is to change the culture of how civil servants work. You might argue like why do civil servants need to do civility testing? But this is a kind of provocation to let them know that the next time when you want to commission somebody, you need to make sure that this is important. So it's not about like we want to educate or empower the civil servants to do what they can do by the designer. It's more like letting know the mindset and how to do things positive. So we go through all of the problems on each page, and then we collaborate together to generate some ideas. And all of the pages are on different workshops, because we have different workshops focus on different needs. So this one is for like problem shooting and synthesize information. And then we come up with some draft idea. And when we have idea, we collaborate with all kinds of stakeholders to come up with prototype. And then we have interactive prototype. And now it's at the stage of coding. And we just do the usability testing again internally. So the project, the online contact system will be launched in April this month.
Takes 1 to 2 weeks for us. We have really limited time.
current policy or service respond to the problem. If you already are doing a good job, then you just have to explain to the public what you have done. But if not, then we have to come up with other solutions together. So those agenda will go into our collaboration workshop to discuss with the different stakeholders. Okay.
So, so I think that we are more probably doing this very key part of the problem itself. And it will be possible for sure. It's very important for this type of
thing.
Thank you for this very amazing presentation. I really enjoyed it. I think it's interesting that you point out how to involve the public servants in this new policy making process. And I wonder, can you elaborate a little bit more about the role of citizens? I'm not saying state, yes, some citizens are stakeholders, but they are more like, as you said, citizens with skills, but we say ordinary citizens. What are their roles in this new policy making process? Are you trying to inform them, or you know, I'm just wondering, can you give us a little bit more information?
They have actually lots of different roles depending on their condition. So if they are really keen to have a say, then they might already do a lot of research on that topic. So they can actually give they can input a lot of information and give suggestions during the workshop. But if some of them, if they are like passive citizens, then maybe they can, the role in the workshop will be re-examining the idea that people have discussed. So maybe they can point out the problems, maybe some part that people are neglected.
So they're like reviewers?
Yeah, more like reviewers. Because sometimes professionals or public servants, they might have there are something that they don't notice. So I think the citizen can help with this.
I think it's really great that you actually train for the city servants so that you give them tools instead of like doing it for them. But then I wonder, is there any challenges? Because then obviously that's not the way that they were doing their thing, and then one was like, maybe you can give us examples on what's the most challenging things when you are doing this to them or like doing it with them. And also, did you see any changes afterwards?
Yeah, the biggest challenge that we have now is around agenda setting. Because lots of the workshop, the agenda that we have now is raised by the public through the inclusion website. But we actually encourage the civil servant to raise their own issues. Because actually, if there's a problem that the public can already notice, then the problem is like a really big problem. So if the civil servant can actually identify the problem that the public doesn't know yet, then it's the best way to do that. So we would like to do projects based on those issues. But it's really difficult for civil servants to raise these kind of issues to us.
Because they're afraid of speaking out, or?
Because if they raise something, then somebody needs to do something wrong.
Yeah. If you raise something, you have to do it.
And they're already busy enough, so they don't want. Their everyday routine.
very dedicated to work on our rainbow projects and our projects. One thing is the shared document. I think it's a very practical one. Instead of attaching a Word document in email and sending it to different people, and probably with those one it was easy, right? We kind of introduced different open source shared document systems, like HAPMD, and maybe Codoc, but if they don't want to pay for Codoc, if there are too many people in the office, then open source shared document solutions would be the best. So we try to show them how we work, just by including all the publication officers from the prepared workshops. We found that she used the prepared document quite well. So when Leo's saw her new shared document, they'll be like, oh, this comrade, she's preparing a workshop, she's a designer, and also not a technician in background, right? So the public servants will be very confident also learning this new technology. And they'll be one of the very little things we inject in the system. But it sounds very small, but I think it's very, it takes a lot of time. Imagine like 30 minutes a day.
I tried to do that in Taipei City government with, I was in their youth committee, and I tried to do that for our meetings with the public servants inside Taipei City government. We were working with four departments, and that was a big undertaking, trying to make a use Google Doc for meeting notes, that's it.
I can think of something that can reduce their cost. But they have to spend some time first. So like mind mapping is something that's really useful for them to accumulate problems, needs, ideas. So if somebody wants to join and solve this problem, they don't have to but they have to build this first, and it takes time. And also, you asked about what our positive changes that we have. So because we aim to drive cultural change, and the way we measure cultural change is by we're collecting evidence that can respond to climate change. So some of the evidence that I already collected are, for one, during the income tax system, the civil servants were really engaged and working with us. So they know where we're coming from and the value of different ways of working. It's not like fancy tools, it's more like the mindset behind it. And I think they totally get it. So when they are going to commission the office company again this year, in the request for proposal, they actually write those tasks that the company has to do in the new form. Yeah, and use a tourism line. So I think that's one positive change. And another one that we collected was from general public. So the citizens who participated in our workshop, some of them mentioned that this is really helpful for them. In the beginning, it's really difficult for them to absorb all of the information all at once, or what they understand. It's really, it helps them a lot to clear their minds. And another thing is, because of this, they can understand. They are not the only person who see this one side. They can see other perspectives. And because of this, they are willing to do more research, understand more different perspective, and that really help them have a more holistic view and become a better citizen that can make a better decision for you. I think this is another problem. Thank you, everyone.
Especially in Espinto, and the Donghua is very popular in Taiwan. And I very like this TV show.
Taiwan, so this series
kids have many criteria. So this is not true. Bioinformatics turned out. Okay. So bring this natural phenomena to the social. So this before the 4 years have this things. Especially this one. CSSTA. So many people these things have many stress or many angry, but they have not to do anything. They just talk, they just to decrease. So they also generate many memes in the social media. And one day, this they talk on the SNS. This is the big T, and there is as well. Okay, and one day is the Sanjubu. Okay, so this maybe it's a KLS or same in the in the social. It's the first one, and the two is occupy. Permanent. So this is number two. And this occupy permanent. More and more people join this. So I also go about the permanent. And many people. So many people feel like this. They will find here are many people in Japan and in Japan. So, okay, so it becomes some positive movement. And this some positive movement is also generate many news, newspaper in Taiwan and also on the New York Times and America. Okay. This is in America. Okay. It also has a conflict. That is the story. This one is also me, so we have a cross or some because okay, I have seen this. It also have you seen him or missing? Okay, and this mean is this means funny because this mean is diversity is here, and this is one day, something burst. And quilt diversity will increase. And creation intensity will grow. Because many creators on the internet, they will focus this thing and create more and more memes about this. And okay. You will create like you will give a few 2 weeks or maybe 3 or 4 weeks in Taiwan. But I don't know in our country below what this. Okay. So it also like in humans the image. Because some will remember this event, and so one day if some event is like before, so they will talk about this generate more and more like this one's meaning, and some will remember and take some actions to do. This So I think many memes and SNS in the social phenomena, you can use the natural phenomena to discuss, to think, or to research. And here also social phenomena also can research the natural phenomena. It's across course.
So I was in the idea that I thought it's a social media expert. Okay. Any questions we have here? If not, we will invite, we'll turn the mic to the Republican Senate and invite Tom first. Okay. Thank you. you someone, if you are interested, you can see from here. And one more thing, I can speak very good Chinese, so don't hesitate to ask me any Chinese.
We are now under a mission of moving forward the concept
really need some work as well. The project is very simple, that it basically allows anyone to rest an empty working space, and you put basically anything you want in the space. So here you can see a very colorful collaboration that we bring this apartment space that people can use in to raise questions or workshops or just go by and have a couple of coffee. So can you hear the parking place? So it's like a parking place, but then because you're anyway paying for that space, so they just use it for whatever. So it's like having the street, public space for civic usage.
Yeah, part of it is all over America.
Yes.
Related to the
investigated 14 cases of citizen innovation around three cities, Copenhagen, Melbourne, and Amsterdam. And in August, we had a workshop with visionaries of urban design in the city that we're involved in. We had Brian Boyd, maybe someone. How can we initiate as to now because the society is changing, and that someone is also taking the bubbles, that means probably the limit of how the energy will be generated, how it will be distributed, what is the limit of communities changing. So I guess they are trying to create the vision around it so they would know what kind of systems can be more active in the future. So that was what I said for. That's the vision design team specifically.
We will basically publish this kind of visions into our website and into Curry events. And we are trying to find partners, like companies or maybe some departments from the government to collaborate with us. To make it large scale.
What do you mean by design infrastructure that's hackable? How do you define hackable?
Hackable is for my opinion, hackable is that you have to make it perfect. You need some space that people can take their hands on it. And like the space you just saw in the picture, that is can easily be changed. Whether the system or the hardware. But we are trying to find out how to do
right. So isn't a parking space very different than say the city's power infrastructure?
Basically they are the same. So the infrastructure, the maintenance, and the large scale
like in Taiwan, our central government has a lot of power, right? Our local government doesn't really have much power, rather than, but they can set little agenda. But most agendas are set in central government. I'm not sure. And so, combining your vision, like, if I'm imagining a decentralized, localized, autonomous infrastructure here in Taiwan, I would think that it would take a lot of political will and political power to make central government give up its power. Be like, okay, you decide. I'm not sure if that's the case in Japan, or like how is local autonomous. Are local communities or city governments powerful enough to make that decision? If that's possible, that's great. Just make everything, make government smaller and make power decentralized. But not sure how would the political process go to be like, okay, central government is essentially delegating all these powers to local people and you can make your own decisions. So that's like how we probably a lot of us imagine the democracy will work. But it's not how it works now.
I think it's important to, I think it will touch somehow my next question, but the primary reason for the national power to use the strength and that they had a bigger power before, but they don't do it so now, is probably something that's happening in everywhere around the world, because there's a lot of problems like aging and inequality is not constantly growing anymore. Japan, we don't really have this sense of growth anymore financially. And then that means the nation can't really say that you don't have this amazing technology and investment all over Japan, just to stay aging, and also the economy itself is never going to be another increase, but we don't really see that. So that means that they have to give away some of the powers and visions that they have had. Just follow us and then you'll be fine. And then you will grow and you will be in prosperity. So in a way, I think there is a little bit of a turning point in the past decade or so where there's more global power. It's not just because of the will of the nation, but it's just we have to be that way because they don't have that kind of power and vision that is just in the way of going this way. So I think that is the reason
why. So you think that they are weaker?
It's not by the choice, but I think it is the way that we need to approach it.
Actually, we have a very good example.
Thank you.
So what kind of relationship between citizens and infrastructures that you want to create? And more precisely, what kind of contribution do you think citizens are able to make to the future of the city or the smart system that you want to create? Or if you have some example or
Yeah, I think the idea is that I'm not sure now.
Okay.
I have a suggestion because we kind of forcefully separated some of the work that we do together to do presentations.
Okay.
So maybe I could also introduce about what we do as a company and also some projects we're doing, and maybe that could be like a seed of inspiration that we can
continue.
Because it seems like we have a lot of different backgrounds in living way or maybe the roles that we take.
Remember our questions.
Yeah. I mean, you can always throw them. Maybe after this all finished, we can ask both of us. At least in Japan, we felt like a for-profit company would be the way to go. we don't have a very strong foundation like Gates Foundation, so we can't be really sort of dependent on those type of foundations for a constant supply of money. So we have to find out the way to sort of drag out some budget from everywhere we can find. That's the reason why that we work together with the governments and universities and companies. So we have not so much more, but this is just some of the representative clients that we've been working across 4 or 5 years. Fukuoka City has been very generous with us, so we worked with them across 4 years. So all these governments, they approach us kindly, so we have some projects with them. Most of them are not really top-down, or it's more bottom-up. They feel like they don't have much institutions that they could turn to, so they come to us to sort of, whenever there's some kind of civic engagement, or they want to come up with something that is an original program that would actually develop some kind of innovation ecosystem, they tend to come to us. And luckily, we also have some opportunity to have Shuya, and that's the reason why that we are here, and then we have these amazing people to talk to. She was with us for 1 year, and then it was amazing that she came and chose to be a part of this movement and the government, and we have been very happy to see her here. So we have the operation in 2 cities, Tokyo and Fukuoka, but we, as I have already said, we work with many different local governments rather than the national ones, and perhaps we will describe the reason why. So the biggest turning points, this was the photo that I actually took by myself, fortunately, and this is the earthquake that you might have heard in 2011 in March. So this was a month after, 4 weeks
after.
Yeah, basically nobody was really encouraged to go there. I mean, volunteers, of course, they can enter, but many people said that there's still the post-quake. So for the safety, most of the people were actually encouraged not to go, because nobody can guarantee whether you'll be safe. But we saw that this is such an important time that we have to understand what is it happening critically, and what are the things that we could do, because we've already had some businesses in the innovation, and we're supposed to know what kind of things that we could do. Lots of failures and lots of stories behind, but in essence, I think we failed. So that's before we, and that was one of the primary reasons that we decided to start the company. And I think the critical learning at that point was, unless we have some kind of a deep understanding, and also unless we try to work with the individuals inside of that city or the region, we could actually sustainably change things. This kind of change doesn't really happen. You can't have, you can't say, like, I'm the expert, I know about innovation, and I come in to solve the problems, which never works. And I think maybe it's more obvious for you, but I think it was kind of a learning for us. But ourselves, we had to go and learn. That was one of the reasons that I've been here. And I think this is our turning point, just like you have mentioned about the Sunflower Movement. But unfortunately, the biggest difference is that this was the force of nature. So we didn't really choose to make this happen, meaning that unlike you guys, we don't necessarily have that kind of civic passion and energy with us that we have. It wasn't something that we did voluntarily. So we have to really find our source and energy and motivation that, you know, whenever something like this happens, that we are able to kind of deal with it. So that's something that is not necessarily coming naturally, and which is in a way very inspiring for us to see something like this, where, you know, people are really seeing and then really making things happen and here and so on. So we call ourselves Think and Do Company, or Think and Do Tech. Because we feel like there needs to be some kind of a theory or the thinking behind what we do. And I think that's quite important, because doing is hard, you know? There's so much... I'm sure you are the practitioners and you are also the thinkers. And if you think about doing the thinking bit and the doing bit, which part of it that you spend more time? Who thinks who spends more time on thinking? Okay, that's great. And then the doing? Yeah. Okay, there's some anonymous people who are not either thinking or doing. Yeah, I'm sure that's not true. But I don't know, it feels like doing has so many unpredictable things. You can't really force people to do the way you expect them to do. So we have to have some kind of theory or vision behind it, or maybe always expect them to do. So we have to have some kind of theory or vision behind it, or maybe always sort of seek for some cases or the predecessors who have made these things happen. One of the examples is that we worked with some of the professors in the University of Illinois who produced this, not a very sexy book, I'm sure. It's not like Teal or Lean, it's not like this best-selling book. But it did really touch upon the really important things about how the corporate innovators make things happen, not just once, but for many times. And these professors made a really intensive study for 10 years. Because they wanted their students to be not an inventor, but an innovator. And that small difference in the words is actually a big difference in how they think and how they make things happen. And we were really encouraged by it, because essentially they were saying, yes, we need some technologically capable people to make things happen, but behind it there's more political or more latent type of skills that they develop over the years. And that does make things happen. And then we worked together with the professors and realized that we actually translated this book, and which gave us the opportunity to dig into the serial innovators in Japan. And we realized that it wasn't the companies or the culture, but it was actually those individuals who had exactly the same type of behavior, regardless of the country. They did all the things that they had to do, and it was very, very similar, and which was really encouraging. So there might be some situations that they are in, and some of them make things happen, and some of them not. But the things that you have to do and things that you have to work for, like intrinsic motivation, and you have to think about who you are serving for, maybe you try to do some more political things, which not all the engineers are good at. So, and then that really made us like a really powerful thoughts. So when some of the local governments now we try to be prepared mentally, what kind of things that we would like to roll out as a program. So this is just one example of what we've done in Hiroshima prefectural government. One time. Okay, I didn't lose the painting, so that's good. So it's about 2.6 million population, 2.6 in prefecture-wise in test courses. So they said, like, yes, we have lots of interesting companies. We have not studied ship companies. We make food, and there's lots of interesting companies, but we don't seem to be doing so well nowadays. Like, there's no new businesses coming out. So when this request came, we sort of took this as an opportunity to practice what we learned from those books that I've introduced earlier, to see if we can actually try to go through this process of, basically it's an incubation, like it's like 5-6 months. We try out people from each company and to see how they can collaborate and then to become the innovators of the next generation beyond the business that they do have now. So 100, it says Innovators 100, it's 100 companies. We are now up to 67. So we will have a couple more years to work on. Thankfully, we have worked with the Hiroshima government for 3 years now. So hopefully we can do more for this type of work. I love this. Because we talked about manga, so this is Hiroshi had been basically sort of supervising, yes. It's design thinking, but in manga. It's funny that I don't think this would be the Western idea, but unfortunately I think this book is saying
amazingly well than this one. And you will see the reason why, because it's all text. Whereas this is so much more easy to understand. So everybody's like, oh, but thankfully for this one, we really, it's easy to understand. It's unthinking when you're just reading the books. And I don't know whether to feel nice about it or not, but it's, at least I think it's a really nice, it's surprisingly well written. So this is, we have many projects and we have different kinds of programs designed and catered for different cities or governments, because we know, we feel like every local government has a limit in the budget. They're never as abundant as the national government. But we try to be sort of, we want to use the budget in a more suitable way. So we do cater and customize different types of projects that we do for different cities. But, so today I wanted to sort of emphasize, although we are thinking and do company, but it is quite important to think. And this is actually a study done by the MediaX of the Stanford University. They've been studying about the irrigation ecosystem. And I think there are many different ways to sort of define the irrigation ecosystem. But in this case, they've been analyzing how each city embraces different types of startups and what are the network they create. So these little dots actually indicate some of the startups, individuals, and then the companies that they have found. Some of them made one, some of them two, or even more. And then green is the financing institution or the investors, for instance. So you see that if these are representing different cities like Paris, Berlin, Stockholm, Eindhoven, Helsinki, and yeah, well, that's right, maybe this is the way, but then when the Silicon Valley comes into picture, you see that all those dots that are fairly okay is like very minute. This is just Silicon Valley hello. So when we saw this, we're like, okay, so a lot of the cities or the countries, Tel Aviv, Israel, Berlin, they talk about, okay, next, the Silicon Valley is, okay, is successful. If we copy them, we can be like them. And this brings us a question, because already even the Paris or the Berlin, it's just uncomparable in size. And we have to think about what is it that San Francisco or the Bay Area has, and whether we would really like to replicate or not. So, this is, I think, different people will have different opinions actually in terms of what kind of drivers or the engine that each city or the system has. And definitely, I think the talent is something that Silicon Valley attracts and holds. And then there's a lot of competition, or the, I don't know, there's a lot of power to try and challenge themselves. I think there's a lot of opportunities there, and they also, of course, try and pivot themselves in terms of markets, like accessing to different types of markets. Who are the users? They try to think about adopting different kinds of technologies or develop different solutions. But the question was, so does Japan, for the one, two, three decades even, a lot of the Japanese companies went and sent people off to Silicon Valley trying to replicate it, and nothing happened. So I don't think this model works, at least in Japan. And just like we've already discussed about this financial growth, the economy growth, I don't think it's something that we see in numbers anymore. So what is it, and do we really want to live like this? There's like a sitcom in Silicon Valley where, you know, they have this crazy Silicon Valley life, and like having like two kids, I don't think I can have that kind of life anyways. And we tried to start to look at different cities. Part of the project was also the national government was doing this kind of research in the US. some opportunities for the different things. I'm sure quite many of you know, so do you know which country this is?
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. Don't tell me the answer. We that's kind of a hint because right. There you go. That's why I hit the name of the system Copenhagen. So there was something that was intriguing about Denmark. Yeah, Noma, which is a three-star Michelin restaurant, which used some of their resources and the local ingredients and has a very high reputation around the world. MIT developed basically that red circle, and basically it's, you know, by just putting it, the normal bicycle becomes electric. But somehow Copenhagen City made it so that it's applicable in their roads, and it became known as Copenhagen Wheel. And that's the insulin pen. Basically it's a shop, but when a lot of pharmaceutical companies were trying to develop better, denser, more effective insulin, this company, basically what they worked on was how people can, you know, without making other people fearful for that, especially if you think about scorpions and if they have to do some shots, I think it's not a very comfortable situation for the other kids. And this is quite, it's easy to use, and then it's also customizable, it's not so intimidating. All these kind of things did really sort of appeal to us. And then we started to think about what is their model or an engine that drives their innovation. And this is sort of our way of understanding, and in essence, I think it is really that citizens that, or the civic mindset that they have that drives innovation. Also, city offers, maybe just like how maybe things are in Taiwan today, we met some of the people who's trying those bicycles yesterday, but given the opportunity where the ideas can be tried out in the city. And also to have some kind of motivation that solution is not just for anybody in somewhere in the world, for some other markets, but they seem to have some kind of intrinsic motivation about what they might accomplish through some of those creations, and to give it back to society. This seemed to be a bit more attractive than this. I don't know, it's a choice, but it's also about thinking about what kind of asset you have locally. And so the reason, one of the reasons why in the end that we started off having just one office in Tokyo, but now we have two offices, one in Gotland and we almost have the same amount of operations. Maybe the goal is even bigger, so I really have to but, I think it is the citizens really get the city has a right size and it's compact and it has sort of like the appreciation for the quality of life, and there's something about it that, you know, we seem to have a lot of work there. So Innovation Studio Fukuoka, we dealt with topics like how to be inclusive, and then how do maybe the kids with a disability can be a part of the society, or all these kinds of things we do as a part of the incubation. So people are essentially 40 or 50 people will come to join this program for half a year, and then they will in the end have their whole startup business. But we basically help them to think about what is it that their business can actually solve problems and really take a critical view. And we're seeing some of those ideas now flourish, which is a really nice thing. And this is one of the things that we're doing, and based on some of those thoughts that we already had before. I think today, depending on how much time we have, I think we can of course introduce a bit about Barcelona. But what really is a question or something that I would love to discuss is civic literacy, or maybe it could be public literacy as well. So how can citizens be actually involved in the shape, in sort of shaping or being a part of the city or the country that they live in? That's not an easy question, and it's also something that we were never taught at school. I mean, at least I wasn't taught how to be a better citizen or how I can be engaged to be sort of give opinions to the way how the public service or the system works. And I don't think it's a one-way street anymore. And whereas Barcelona gave us recently when we visited some thoughts about not just about how citizens are engaged, but also the public sort of facilities. And I think here, because a lot of people are coming from, of course, Shreya comes from the PDX, and we're thinking about a lot of public facilitation as well. So maybe it would be nice to think about it from both ends. Like, what do you think actually would be a skill set or the ability that we should obtain to create that kind of better future, like as an ecosystem or together? And that's something that I would actually love to discuss. How are we with time? And then depending on that, I would briefly discuss about Barcelona. But this is about it for the as an introduction of what we do as a company.
I'm curious about your business model. I saw you have many sponsors. So do you supply or provide advisors to the sponsors, or the projects are maintained by you, by your company, and the sponsors just give you money?
Advisors? You mean, do they come and tell us what we should do?
要是你，啊，通用药也得有噶，所以多么，我们project哦，是跟两代，project哦，两代，对，project哦，两代，对，可能有两家，那那那那就有噶。Both，嗯，so，both ones，啊，那。But
typically they come to us saying like, we like campus. Usually they ask here from our local governments and saying like, oh, I heard that you're doing this in Boca. We want to do the same thing here. And then first we say, that's not possible because Kumbuka is one of the most lively, youngest city with abundant resources. And it, yeah, I mean, in Japan, I think it's the youngest city that we have right now. And then it has a lot of attraction. A lot of people are tired of Tokyo world. There's a good balance of good food and quality of life, and it's a very compact. And it's quite easy to do. So if other municipalities come and they say that I want to have the same program as them, first we have to say no. Because they cannot have, because they don't have the same asset, right?
But don't you think about some modified version for them?
Modified version.
Like a core site cluster.
Yes, so that's where the conversation starts.
Okay.
At least we know that they have interest to do something bottom up. And then we will actually start. So actually, one of the places that Hiroshi is now engaged in is Kumamoto, which recently had the earthquake. And they are in a much inferior situation than in Fukuoka. So what we start from is the really actually research. So we really need to understand who are there, who's actually trying to change things, who are the academics who can tell us more about culture and what are the resources, what are the mindsets. So from there we design and propose back.
So how did you convince the Fukuoka government in the first time?
We actually spent a couple months to 6 months as long as to communicate and discuss what the role would be the best for us to propose. So, yeah. And basically, the process was originally made out of this
So you don't just
we did have a bit of an advantage, which is that Hiroshi was the director of high school, which was the very first innovation education curriculum, which was organized in the University of Tokyo. So they knew, actually, in Fukuoka City knew something about us, that we are capable to do something around innovation, although we didn't do this kind of local government project. And once that is done, and it is not us to promote, the people who participated and also the governments, they have their own network. So we never actually pitched, never so far, they came to us.
So the direction is government to CISA.
Yeah. But then that's where the conversation and the challenge starts, that we say, okay, you're paying, but our ultimate customer is citizens, right? So if that kind of conversation is over theoretically by giving the budget.
I think the most important question problem of this model is if the government does nothing, so nothing will happen.
Very important. Yeah. Yes.
And Taiwan is
my best shot. She knows too much about Japanese culture. But definitely the government that we have consecutive, because you know, government only has annual budget, right? We have projects which run across 3 years, 4 years, but they never can promise that we will actually definitely have 5 years' time. But the reason why we have this kind of continuity is because not only that we managed to do it, but also we have a really great counterpart. So in the public service sector, there were also change agents who understood what we do, and then also they themselves became a sort of a provocation.
Talk about to sending spies into the government.
What?
Sending spies.
Sending spies?
make someone want to do this, but the government don't want to do it. So if this is that man goes into the government and becomes elected.
No, I mean, you're both your English and Japanese are amazing, so. The person who drives innovation and then can really secure a budget for consecutive years, they cannot be just like a new in the system.
Too long term.
They can't be a junior in the institution. They have to have some kind of a role already in the government. But we do just 1 year of enrollment, and whether they can change or not. Well, they already have some potential, but I think they change dramatically across the year. And those are the cities or the prefectures that we are involved. Goes to involve Fukui, Fuji, and then Fukuoka, and then Hiroshima. And those are the cities that we found such counterparts. And also the participants became like pressure. They tell the government, you're not supposed to quit this. You're not intending to quit this program, are you? And then they are pressured somehow. So once that is rolled out, we are in a much safer position to make this more impactful.
Yeah, I mentioned this because the entry time is only 33. So young men can, in Taiwan, young men can have a very high position in the government, and so they can have, well, pressure from outside.
I'm not quite sure the politics, so we don't have such a young and powerful leaders necessarily. But,
I think we're doing quite well with the management, especially where the census are around. And
I want to hear about
the Yeah, about the right. So who wants to hear about the Tsunamis?
I will make it short. So, who's been to Barcelona? It's a nice city, isn't it? it's true, it's a destination, one of the primary destinations for the tourists. Actually, there's 10 times more tourists than the citizens itself. So, but that's also a risk when the tourism is so big, the citizens and their rights or the power can be compromised for the sake of those temporary visitors. So Barcelona is going through a lot of transitions now where they are not so proactive about more tourism, but they are now more like in the reflexive time. Some of you may have seen the news that Catalonia, in Barcelona as a metropolitan city, but the Catalonia state itself is trying to be independent from Spain. And which is quite understandable because Spain as a country, it only has a history, it has started only in 1975, whereas Barcelona and its area, they had the city, and they've been very active before Christ. So they have this sense that they have had this culture before, but the Catalan language was suppressed throughout the Spain Rhine. So now the language itself and their culture is now reviving. And 4.7 million inhabitants in the metropolitan area, maybe about less than 2 million. It's about twice the size. Right, 1.6. And there's this little space called Poblenou, which is their innovation district at the moment. So one of the last frontier of development, and that's where many things and experimentation is taking place. Both from the infrastructure wise and also from the city looks like this from 1859. So it's very much the grid. Not everything people made was possible, but they were, have thought about sort of having same infrastructure throughout the city. And as you can see, so it's a very much grid-based city. Not everywhere is like this. And this blue area is this innovation sort of district at the moment. Have you heard of superblocks? Does anybody has anybody heard of them? Yes. No, I'm not talking about you. Superblocks is quite interesting. I think if you look up the word, you might come across with some of the videos, especially the one from Vox or The Guardian also has some articles about it. Basically, the idea is very simple. So if you take all these blocks, now it's just typically every road would have car streets. So that's the public area. But their idea is that in order to reduce the air pollution and also to improve the citizens' lives, they take these 9 blocks as a super block, and all these inward roads, they're trying to regulate, so to reduce the amount of cars and also to reduce the speed. So what could happen is that essentially once this is rolled out, this is now the street. For the road network, for the cars. But once this is executed, those primary roads will be in red, so they will reduce the car streets by 61%. And what this means is that the citizens' accessible space, currently they have some kind of small pedestrian roads or parks, but very much scattered and only limited to some parts of the city. But they will have it throughout the city, meaning they will have more public spaces available for its citizens. Now, I'm talking about the infrastructure, so it seems rather irrelevant. But the idea is this. This is a famous drawing from the New York Times, and it's old one. This is not done by the Barcelona. But the way that we are now dealt in the public area or the streets is that because the car takes so much space, essentially, citizens are somewhat downgraded into to pedestrians. So what they're trying to do is basically regain some of the public spaces, which is now occupied by cars, and to have more citizens' activities. So the part of things which Joan tried to explain a little bit is also not just about occupying park space, to encourage citizens to sort of redesign and to regain their public civic activities onto the public area. So essentially, currently, they have primarily the streets are occupied by cars by 54%, but they're trying to reduce it like this. So that's the whole plan is designed by an institution called Barcelona Ecologia, which is a strategic planning institute, but not what is called a government. It is kind of like advisory and a strategy planning team or institution that they have. They only have 20% of their budget coming from the city, so they basically earn the rest of the money by doing business or introducing the same kind of concept to different cities. So this is the picture that they provided us. So now, if everything is just a public normal road, it's citizens and the cars. But what they're trying to do is to use these inner circles as a public space, and then to let those community decide what they want to do it here. So the ones that I've seen is like, they basically block some of those roads and they redesign them, but with a very agile thing. It's just a huge plant pot. So you can drink an idea and just bring it and just leave it there, and then whatever you can do is some kind of super rock-ish thing. And if nobody likes it, they can remove it. So it's very experimental. The one I've seen was that in that circle here, all these dots are the circles, this area has decided to make a park for kids. So it's the little ones that only the kids can actually play. It's very small, but this type of activities can take place. So I found this quite interesting and very encouraging. And the idea for them is that not only that they would adjust and make this happen in a very limited area, they would like to do it throughout the city. They're also redesigning the bus routes, which is now like spaghetti. But they're now trying to do it in much more in an organized way, so that everyone can use public transportation instead of being dependent on cars. So it's not about just sacrificing their benefits, but they are able to use public transportation because it is their choice rather than being restricted. I think this is something that I would love to sort of discuss, but I was really inspired because experimentation is one thing, and often we feel that it's quite small compared to the city or the whole entity that we're seeing. But this kind of mindset that experimentation is just the beginning, but then it will be, if somebody would have this kind of vision that this could actually be throughout the city, it's really about providing the service not just for a limited amount of people, but to have opportunity for everyone else. There's also some interesting things going on. I think one of the Fab Labs, which is one of the most successful ones around the world, is probably the one in Barcelona, because the city has been sort of promoting and encouraging Fab Lab in the city, across the city. And we visited one of the institutions, Institute for Advanced Architecture of Catalonia. And they've been doing some project like citizen sensing. They have now a free download document called Citizen Sensing Toolkit. And they have a device which can sense different type of things, whether it's the air pollution, whether it's the sound, or it could be the temperature. But interesting thing is that actually the citizens who are involved in this can decide what should be measured. So in city of Barcelona, they realized PPC actually. So that's Barcelona's plaza by day, but this is at night. So you see people drinking beer. Can you? So because it's cheaper to just drink on this, in this free space, so they just buy beer and they just sit down and drink. But for the neighborhood, it's quite loud. And in the Barcelona, people they sleep during the day, so they have all night. So the day and the night is equally active, which is not such a comfortable thing for the neighborhood. So what they're doing is that we found it. We found the proof that it's working, right? So facing the plaza, they have this device which is developed by Navarra. And then what they've done is communally they've decided what to sense. So in this case, it is suggested so that this sensing device is to collect data of the noise, the sound level. They can actually see what kind of problems they have collectively. Because sometimes maybe city will say, yes, we have air pollution problem, so we will measure the air pollution. But maybe that's not the most important thing or the critical thing for the citizens or the neighborhood. So this actually enables them to decide what exactly as a collective or a community that they would like to collect data and to appeal. So this became one of the glue for those communities to discuss about what is the problem that they're seeing and what kind of data they should be collecting. It's interesting because they are trying to use blockchain as well, so they can actually trace back to whoever actually collected the data. So it kind of increases and empowers the citizens' ownership. So, I don't know, there's a little bit more about the concept or the mindset that they have behind it, which is about sustainability and diversity. They were also saying that, okay, as long as we have a lot of budget, of course we can bring water from Russia or gas from Russia or who knows. There are ways to supply energy and then to fulfill the a service for the citizens, but that requires a lot of cost and that requires a lot of energy, and that's not really sustainable. And in no city we have that kind of budget anymore. So instead of really creating a lot of chaos and energy required way of sustaining the city, they're trying to reduce that type of consumption, try to have a more locally sort of sustainable way of running the city. If I had more time, I would have gone through it. And then the H is more about the diversity. So rather than having like migrants would live here, elderly would live here, the rich ones are here, but that's maybe as a collective, as a city, we might be diverse. But in a way, it's ultimately segregated, right? And that doesn't mean that you have that kind of rich society where different cultures converge. So they were saying that yes, we need to have different kinds of people involved, not in a limited place, but throughout the city. So everyone could have the benefit of having those different type of people inside, and also some different kinds of public services inside that neighborhood. That's something that they're now trying to think about. So. Lastly, I think these are not the things that we are thinking, but I think what we are saying is that instead of just a simple top-down where the institutions actually make things and then citizens actually would be the recipient of it, definitely I think there's this element of citizens also appealing to the institutions. But the question is that when the citizens become a group, sometimes it become quite small. The same interest to have that kind of a group and then have one type of a field, you tend to have the one similar group of interest. So I think what's ideally what we try need to do from now on is that rather than having either a citizen or an institution, I think we have to find a way to group ourselves into a collective of different type of people work together and then try to experiment. And in the process of experimentation, just like that citizen sensing device have made or united that community around the plaza, having that kind of collective and then doing things together seems like one of the important ones that we see today, especially I think in quite a few of the European cities. So, sorry it was very quick and I don't think I really explained properly, but probably it's better that we will, instead of me trying to explain, maybe it's better that we will try to discuss about this. I've sort of started to list about what kind of literacy or what kind of things that the principles there might be about, so public literacy and civic literacy, but this is still a very sketchy idea and it might be good as a starting point. So I feel like there are some things that one, either the citizens or the public sectors are better at or more than taking the initiative, but hopefully we have more better understanding of how we can create sort of collective. Might be actually a good thing to discuss about how we can make a better sort of city altogether. So that's